Thank you. Yes, first meeting of Marxism, and unfortunately the malfunction is quite a major one, because I had a whole bunch of exciting slides, dynamic slides, which I was going to bore you stupid with over the next 30 minutes or so. We'll see if we can work that out. Otherwise, I'm just going to have to kind of blag this from the additional notes that I've got. I'm hoping that I've just, like as I normally do, massively over-prepared and got way too much material so that I can fill the 30 minutes and talk us through it. Anyway, well done for getting here. This is the first of a series of meetings around LGBT and trans issues, which are going on through the weekend. We're also meeting, obviously, the day after the budget, aren't we? A budget which I'm sure all of us recognise as being one which is a massive attack on especially young people. And when it comes to, for example, young LGBT people, young trans people, young gay people, trying to live their lives, the budget is only going to make it so much worse for young people. I had a series of pictures. Imagine there are pictures. Okay. One of those pictures, the first one I was going to start off with, was a photograph of an activist, a revolutionary activist, called Leslie Feinberg. I put that up particularly because Leslie Feinberg died between the last Marxism, and this Marxism. And I think it's important to actually mention her, talk about her a little bit, because she was certainly a major factor in my life and in my process of kind of coming out as a trans person, but I think has been hugely influential for so many, particularly transgender people. She died actually, I think it was last November, quite relatively young, and died actually, arguably, as a result of the kind of transphobia that she faced in her life. She died of complications due to Lyme's disease, which is a tick-borne disease. She had a whole series of tick-borne diseases and had enormous trouble through her life trying to access appropriate medical care. She was clearly kind of discriminated against in terms of access to healthcare and access to medical care because of her trans status. Her significance, really, in terms of the movement, is that she was a revolutionary Marxist. She didn't come from the same political tradition that the SWP comes from, the International Socialist Tradition. She was a member of a Marxist organisation in America, editor of their newspaper, and had a long, long history of activism as a trade union activist, as a revolutionary activist, as a gay rights and gay liberation activist for a long, long time. She wrote a number of books which I would commend to people to have a look at. The one that I think is the best in many ways and the most significant, so I guess, for our purposes here today in terms of looking at the history, is this one. It's Transgender Warriors. I know Bookmarks managed to get hold of some copies of this, and that they have had copies available, but I would definitely recommend this. I'm not going to spend an awful lot of time on it, but what she does is she goes through the history, particularly of transgender and transgender expression in different societies over a period of time. She makes the point, which is an essential point, I think, for us as Marxists, she makes the point that transphobia has not always existed. It is not endemic, you know, in the same way that homophobia is not endemic to human society and to human beings. It arises out of the material conditions as a forms of oppression which arise out of the material conditions that we face as human beings in trying to produce the goods and the services and the means of life that we need to do. And it varies from one form of society to another. She goes way back to the Bible and points to, if you're actually interested in this, I don't know, maybe you do read the Bible frequently, I don't know. But you can go back and you can find, and I can see somebody in the audience who does read the Bible and speaks on it very well. But if you go back to Leviticus, I'm sure you'll correct me if I'm wrong, but Leviticus and Deuteronomy, there's lots and lots of proscriptions in there, which you you're not allowed to do all sorts of things. And Leslie Feinberg makes the point, I think very well, that why would this all be codified? Why would these prescriptions against forms of sexuality outside the bounds of the nuclear family, outside the bounds of essentially binary gender expression, why would these be condemned if they weren't seen as a problem by the emerging ruling classes of that period? And why would they not be prescribed if they weren't actually already in existence, if they were not fairly common and accepted perhaps in those societies? She documents a whole series of societies where particularly gender variant behaviour has been tolerated and sometimes celebrated over the period. I'm not going to talk too much more about this because I did a meeting a couple of years ago. I think I got as far as the Middle Ages. I was supposed to do right up to modern times, and I never got that far. It's a bit hard to rely on your audience members to fill in 500 years of history. So I'm not going to do that. You'll be pleased to know. However, the title is, when I came to start writing this a couple of weeks ago, I thought, bloody hell, Marxist history of gender and sexuality, what could be broader and bigger? So it is going to be a bit focused, I think, particularly around, obviously, LGBT issues. But those issues also roll over, don't they, into issues of women's oppression and the whole nature of the family and the role of the family, particularly in capitalist society. I was also going to flash up, again, imagine, if you will, a lovely summer's day in Athens a few weeks ago. Yes. And I had a great photo of actually it was women mainly protesting, they weren't protesting for a change. They were celebrating the no vote, and it was absolutely fantastic. That is significant for us here in terms of our attempts to build a mass movement against austerity. Actually, it makes it so much easier for us. I was talking to some comrades last night, speculating about what the impact could be, for example, on the argument about what we say when it comes to the referendum, what people on the left say when it comes to the referendum of Europe, in Europe. And that vote, that blow against austerity, is good for all sorts of oppressed groups, including LGBT people, who have suffered really quite badly through the cuts that have been implemented by the coalition government, the previous coalition government, and continue to be implemented in the massive attacks that have come through the budget yesterday. Then I was going to show you a picture of Istanbul Pride, and people may well know the last year Istanbul Pride was very big. I think it was something like 100,000 people came out on the demonstration. It was a fantastic event. This year the riot police attacked the Istanbul Pride and used pepper gas, tear gas, pepper sprays, truncheons, water cannon to try and drive people off. And of course the argument here was that it was during Ramadan, that it was an offence and so on. The reality was actually that it was about the government of Turkey under pressure now, because there has been the growth of left anti-austerity organisations in the last election, and they lost a good deal of their votes, and they lost a huge number of seats as well. What does a government do in those kind of situations when they begin to feel under pressure? They start hitting out and scapegoating minority groups and oppressed groups. And that's clearly what they've done. The photo, I don't know if anybody saw it. I can't remember where I got it from. I filched it off the Tinter web somewhere. But it was kind of ironic because it was showing people fighting back. And that was a fantastic thing to see as well. And it reminded you actually of how all of this, the modern gay liberation movement took off, which was as the outcome of the Stonewall Rebellion in 1969. People had enough, and they stood up and they fought back 3-4 days of rioting led to, you know, the growth of the emergence of the Gay Liberation Front and the prides, the pride marches, which we kind of take for granted these days as, you know, part of the fabric of political life, part of the fabric of LGBT life. In fact, you know, they didn't exist prior to 1971. But it showed people fighting back, and you know, fighting back really bravely. When you're unarmed, some of you are sure veterans of having been attacked by the police. You know how hard that is when you're, you know, attacked by heavily armed police. And it was incredibly brave to do that, and really quite inspiring that they could do, that they could fight back in the way that they did as well. And we, you know, we should wish those comrades, you know, fantastic solidarity for what they did. The picture itself was kind of ironic because it was a shot of a street, and as they were using the water cannon, and it was a sunny day, you saw it, yeah? There was this fantastic rainbow created <Yeah. laughs> across the protesters, which, you know, wasn't that ironic, but, you know, nicely done kind of thing. Okay, so that's good. There were, again, I didn't have a picture of London Pride. I actually missed London Pride this year. You won't believe this. I've gone for years and years and years, and I was obviously coming down to this one. And I thought, I'll go and spend a few days on the Isle of Arran. That's a great idea, you know, and come down on the Friday night and so on. Guess what? There was a strike. There was the CalMac ferry workers struck. I mean, it's absolute, of course, it's an absolute terrible, terrible disaster to be stranded on a holiday island by a strike. But a bit ironic, I thought. But anyway, there you go. So I never actually made it to Pride. But, of course, there were a whole bunch of issues and arguments around the organisation for Pride this year, which... you know, comrades may well have followed, and which are going to continue in the discussions that people will be having about what we do next year. Because we know, you know, lesbians and gays support the miners were supposed to. The agreement apparently was that they would kind of head up the march. You know, the impact of the film Pride, a fantastic film, has been so enormous, hasn't it? And that, you know, that was something which I'd have thought most LGBT people would have absolutely supported. In the end, what happened was they had to, you know, they had to kind of retreat a bit, really, and head up the trade union section rather than the head. And they still had, I didn't see it there, but they still had the kind of the Barclays and the this, that, and the other corporate sponsors at the head of the march. So there's a whole argument there to be had about the nature of Pride and recapturing that notion of, you know, Pride as protest, you know, in the future. You know, to get back to really the question which the early LGBT movement addressed absolutely directly, which was the question of liberation. You know, that we are not fighting for, you know, or at least we're not fighting just for better rights at work, just for legislation for same-sex marriage and whatever. We are, as socialists anyway, we are fighting for liberation, a world in which, you know, we recognise that the distortions, the pressures, the alienation that we face within capitalist society actually distorts everybody's lives, not just lesbians, gays, bisexual, transgender people, genderqueer people, or whatever. It distorts everybody's lives, and the ultimate solution has to be one where we fight for, you know, liberation, and that can only come about through a revolution. There can be no revolution without, you know, without gay liberation, and there can be no gay liberation without revolution, ultimately. And I think, you know, that if there's one kind of lesson from this talk, in case I forget to make it at the end, that's it, it seems to be. So there are also a whole bunch of other things. I mean, I'm not trying to knock the kind of same-sex marriage advances, because I mean, the one that really stunned me was Ireland. I mean, wasn't that incredible? You know, you've gone from what was a fairly, you know, really quite a repressive Catholic-dominated society to one in which, well, I forget the vote, was it about two-thirds or something, yeah, wasn't it? In fact, two-thirds, yeah. Despite all... Great. Yeah, it was fantastic. despite all the kind of, you know, the idea that there were a bunch of men in black dresses standing at the side and down with this sort of thing. Which, stop it immediately. Anyway, it was... So you had, you know, Ireland is fantastic. There's the recent vote in the USA, wasn't there, to, you know, to federalise the right to gay marriage. France was 2013, I think, France, wasn't it, the same year as the UK. So those things are fantastically important, you know, because they are real advances. They address clear aspects of discrimination against LGBT people, without a doubt. Whether people choose to follow through with that, I mean, the counter-argument is a clear one as well, isn't it? The counter-argument is that the state, the ruling parties, will grant these reforms because they actually don't necessarily really undermine the whole ideology of the nuclear family. That, you know, many people may well buy into that process, buy into being, you know, quotes, you know, part of normal family life, and so on. So that, you know, that's the other side of it, really. There has been some very interesting stuff recently as well about. Specifically transgender issues. There's been quite a lot of publicity, actually. There was, in this country, I don't know, people may have followed the case of Kelly Maloney, who had been a former boxing promoter, who transitioned, I think, last year. And there was quite a lot of, actually, quite a lot of favourable and sympathetic press. I mean, I listened to some interviews on Radio 4 and such like. I didn't actually realise, I don't know if you realise this, but Kelly Maloney, when Kelly Maloney had been Frank Maloney, was actually a UKIP candidate. Did you know this? I hadn't realised this. Like, what? I was sort of thinking, well, I'm going to use this as a great example of LGBT liberation. Possibly not, I thought to myself. I mean, she apparently refused to, when she was a candidate, refused to go and campaign for the for UKIP in Streatham, because apparently Streatham was too full of gays. And it's really quite horrible homophobic comments that were made. And those of you who may be sympathetic to Freudian ideas will no doubt, you know, see that as some forms of, you know, transference or whatever, but there you go. And I don't know, I think she has kind of backpedaled a little bit from those statements, but I don't think she's backpedaled all that much. But it also goes to, I suppose it also goes to prove, doesn't it, that there is no kind of natural affinity between oppressed, you know, categories of oppressed people. Unfortunately, we know that to be the case. I guess the other one I was going to talk about was Caitlyn Jenner, which I did that. It was a bit of a hurried bit, but I did a bit in Socialist this month's Socialist Review on that, because it has excited a big debate around issues of, I mean, to put it, it's basically who is a real woman and who isn't. What is the definition of a woman, or a man for that matter? And the Caitlyn Jenner's case. Caitlyn Jenner, again, I don't. You probably followed this a bit, but I didn't. I have to say, I'm not an avid watcher of the Kardashians, Meet the Kardashians. perhaps you are, I don't know. So I didn't know who you know, Bruce Jenner was until somebody pointed it out to me. But, I mean, that was an interesting case because Caitlyn Jenner excited quite a lot of press comment. And again, it was a very high-profile case. I mean, I think it was very good for trans people, actually. I think it's a very good thing that, you know, the coverage was not salacious, you know, as it so often is in relation to people who transition. It appeared not to be mostly salacious, but it did come under some, she did come under some criticism from, I guess, two avenues, really. One was a kind of a class argument, really, which was that she is rich. She's famous. She can afford the surgery. She can afford the cosmetic surgery. She can afford the hormones without having to go past the medical gatekeepers. And that is a real problem for trans people. You know, the levels of unemployment are so high, particularly young people, levels of homelessness. How do you access that when you've got to go through a whole series of medical gatekeepers and be somehow defined as worthy of worthy of support and help? Well, in her case, she could simply afford it. I mean, her transition was actually quite rapid for many trans people. It is over many years. You know, it takes a long time. So there was that understandable, I think, kind of sense. Well, she's not really like us because she's rich and famous and so on and so forth. I understand that, but you know, I still think we should welcome welcome what she has done and what she has been able to be as a role model. The other argument was one which people may want to address later, but it's the question of what it is, this definition of gender. This is the definition of what is a woman. And there has, for a long time, been considerable debate between some people who take a kind of radical feminist and position rooted in identity politics, really, which attacks some trans people for, as it were, masquerading as women or invading women's space. You know, there are those kind of arguments which are there, and they did emerge in some of the articles around Caitlyn Jenner. They're not things that you can ignore, because this, you know, those debates, those discussions, I think we have to address them with a materialist response, but they are clearly there, and you do come across them. I mean, other examples would be a couple of years ago, there was a huge furore, really, within and between, again, transgender individuals and groups, and the Rad Femme organisation that organised the London conferences. They banned trans women. So you had to be a genetic woman to be involved. And that led to, again, a whole series of arguments about, well, how do you define this? How do you, what is the definition of a woman? And it, to be, you know, you can go back in the history of sort of trans activism to, for example, April Ashley. People remember April Ashley. When I was young, which is a very long time ago, the only model that I was aware of, really, well, there were two trans models that I was aware of. One of them was April Ashley, who was a trans woman, a model, who married, I think she married a lord, I can't remember, some aristocrat. And it all kind of went wrong, and there was a divorce case. And the grounds being cited for the divorce were that the marriage should be annulled because she was not a proper woman. And the judgment made in that court set back trans rights quite considerably by decades, because the judgment was that to be, essentially what came out of it was that to be a woman, you had to be able to bear children. Now that poses some problems, doesn't it? Because, you know, what about, for example, intersex individuals who may, you know, not have that equipment, as it were? What about women who are sterile? How elastic should this definition be? Those arguments kind of go on, and they have political implications, very serious political implications, actually. I was going to also show you a photograph of. Aha.
Uh-huh. It's behind you.
Aha. Uh-huh. Okay, good, right. Well, let's stick it on that. Oh, you've moved it. Right. I'll go back, because this is a case in point, actually. This is C.C. McDonald, who a few years ago was sentenced to 3.5 years in jail, initially in a male prison. She's transgender. She was attacked by a knife-wielding transphobic person. And in the fight, she killed this attacker, and she was accused of murder, and found guilty, and ended up serving. She had to do a deal. I think her defence lawyers did a deal for her, and she ended up in jail. The point I'm making here is that, you know, again, it's about the definition of a woman. You know, people. You know, think about asylum. There are plenty of asylum seekers, for example, transgender asylum seekers, who end up in the inappropriate detention centre, who not only do they have the problem of how do you convince the border authorities and that you are, in fear of your life, that you are, you come from being harassed and so on, but then they put you in a detention centre, put women in trans women in a male detention centre. I had an example. I don't think I've got it on here, but a woman who'd been trying to get through the Mexican border as an asylum seeker from Guatemala, right, okay, whoops, okay, from Guatemala initially. And she was in that position and had suffered. I mean, she detailed the kind of things that she'd suffered, you know, regular abuse, regular physical and sexual abuse by guards and by other prisoners. And that's the kind of thing, you know, people end up kind of suffering. In Cece McDonald's case, I think she's actually out of jail now. But interestingly, by the way, the hand there is Leslie Feinberg's hand. She visited her in prison and took the photo. And she was part of the solidarity campaign for Cece McDonald. Right. Okay. I've said a note to myself. Don't make this a gender studies class, right? Yeah, okay. So, the basic points, I don't know whether, try moving on and see where we come to. It's all an exciting adventure now, isn't it? I've no idea where we are. Yeah, that's fine. That's, right, stop there. Yes, that's, I raised this. This is Janice Raymond, who is somewhat of a hate figure for trans people, with some justification, it has to be said. Janice Raymond. I mean, if you kind of follow this stuff, it's called the Turf Wars, trans exclusionary radical feminists. I have to hasten to add here, by the way, that many feminists, including many radical feminists, actually are not trans exclusionary. Right? It is not true that all are, and many people can work as socialists, you know, we can work with many feminists, and particularly I think this is true probably of younger the sort of new generation, sort of third wave feminists, who are, it seems, much more open to ideas of transgender and working together with trans people. I was really chuffed actually on the June 20th demonstration, how many young LGBT people there were on it. Well, loads, including lots of young trans people. And that was fantastic to see, because, you know, they've got the kind of energy which sad old sods like me and one or two of you may not have, so long.
Is that an official name, Turf? Do they call it?
No, I don't think so. It's a term of abuse applied by trans people. To be honest, but it has. I mean, I'll give you an illustration of how it has political consequences. Because when Stonewall kicked off, that fantastic rebellion that took place, and the Gay Liberation Front picked up, formed. I mean, again, fantastic, fantastic event, because it brought together people who were oppressed because of their sexuality and their gender expression, who were also often veterans of other struggles. So they were often black, they were often Latina, they were fighting for the rights, fighting against racism, fighting for women's liberation. Often they were, particularly in America, they were anti-war activists, had been involved in the anti-war movement. And so the very name GLF, Gay Liberation Front, was modeled on, if you like, the most radical political anti-war movement, modelled on the National Liberation Front of Vietnam, actually, North Vietnam. And it was very much consciously a kind of a revolutionary position. Now, we might say it's kind of, maybe it was naive in some ways, maybe, but they saw themselves as fighting for liberation, fighting to change the world, not to simply find a comfortable place for themselves within that world, not just fighting for, you know, changes in legislation or changes in rights, but actually fighting to liberate, themselves and all of mankind. It involved, the rebellion itself involved many trans people, drag queens, drag kings, street sex workers, and so on. It involved also a trans woman called Sylvia Rivera. Now, she's mentioned, I'm really pleased to see that she was mentioned in Noel Halifax's article in this month's review. Very good article, I thought, which makes explicit the links between, you know, the fight against racism in America and the Black Panthers as the kind of main expression or key expression of that, the most militant expression of that, and people, gay activists at that time, and the links that they made, they recognised that if you are fighting the same oppressor, even if you might have different oppressions, your interests lie in working together. Your interests lie in the unity of the class and overcoming the divisions within that class, which are impressed upon us to try and make us, you know, so much weaker in terms of how we resist and how we change, how we resist austerity, how we resist exploitation, and how we fight together. And this was a period in which that movement sadly split fairly quickly within a couple of years, and Sylvia Rivera was prevented from speaking at the, I think it was the 1973 Pride, because it was felt by the organisers then that they didn't want people like her. They didn't want the most radical gays, the socialist gays. They didn't want the street transvestites and the street transsexuals and so on that march or organised. She was prevented from speaking, and it was the split, wasn't it, between believing those who believe that the only thing you can do really is to get some reforms, get yourself elected to this or that, petition the city council, get extra rights at work if you can. These are all good things to do, by the way, but if that is the horizon of your struggle, it's actually limited. And as I say, there was a whole series following on from Sylvia Rivera not being allowed to speak. There were a whole series of issues where trans women in particular were excluded from women's liberation organisations. And it was on the basis, essentially, of the growth of an identity politics, which said that what's important is how you define yourself in contradistinction to how other people are defined. What divides us rather than what unites us? And that argument is, it is still, I'd suggest to you, it's still dominant. It's still dominant within the women's movement. It's still dominant within the LGBT and transgender movement. It's something we need to engage with, because the reality is that, and there's a whole lost history here, you know, when have been the times when LGBT people, I know they weren't, that acronym was not applied until relatively recently, but when have LGBT people made the biggest advances? Though they've made the biggest advances when the struggle has been at its height, when workers have been fighting for their rights, because what's more fundamental is not how we're divided according to our particular oppression or our multiple oppressions, but actually how we are exploited by a system whose purpose is to drag profit out of us, come what may, and to divide us up and make us, you know, try and make sure that we can't fight back. I'll give you the examples. This is the history bit. The key example, of course, is the Russian Revolution. Prior to that, many of the early socialist organisations and many of the early LGBT activists, Edward Carpenter's, Havelock Ellis, and so on in this country, were actually founder members of socialist organisations, including actually revolutionary socialist organisations. But they were certainly members of the Independent Labour Party, founders of the Labour Party, and so on. And they associated with socialists, and they supported, you know, workers' struggles. So that it was taken for granted that you needed to fight for both sexual liberation and to change the world as workers. Okay, the Russian Revolution was the high point of that. The Bolsheviks were absolutely clear that to be a successful revolutionary organisation and to be successful revolutions, you had to be tribunes of the oppressed. Lenin used that phrase. You had to be tribunes of the oppressed. You cannot just fight on the economic issues. You had to address the problem that we have in capitalism, which is the constant ideological attempts to divide us up between, you know, different forms of oppression. Revolutionaries have to take that seriously and to do everything that we can in terms of trying to unite that. And it was successful. The only and first successful socialist revolution. What did it do? Within 2 months of that revolution, they had decriminalized homosexuality, way, way in advance of any other country. They had made divorce legal. There was abortion rights. There was a whole series of, you know, things which were massively important for for women and for people who, you know, who were trying to explore also, people like Clara Zetkin and so on, who were advocates essentially of different forms of having relationships with people, and you know, recognizing that these had to be fought for in the context of the fight to overturn the capitalist society. The bad times, I'm going to finish on these now. I'm going to it later, but anyway, the bad times were the 1930s, the defeat of the German Revolution, the, you know, the rise of the Nazis. For example, the fact that the Sex Institute formed in Berlin was, you know, that all the books, the library was burnt. There's a famous photograph of them being burnt by the Nazis, by Nazi militia, in 1933. In the concentration camps, 50,000, it's reckoned, 50,000 LGBT people died during that. And they were still in the camps after the war, by the way. You know, and the provisions under which they were sent to the camps remained on the German statute book into the 1950s. The period when we made the gains were the 1960s in particular. That rise, you know, the changes in the way society was organised, the fact that so many more people were going to university and higher education, women were coming into the workforce, there was the economic boom and so on. These material factors led to the, you know, the fight to overturn women's oppression and to address the question of LGBT rights. And the bad time again, if you like, comes from the 1970s. I mean, it's much more complicated than I'm presenting it, but, you know, that retreat, ideological and political retreat from the struggles of the 60s and the early 70s, that retreat had its, it was fueled and also fueled an ideological recasting. In other words, a retreat by a whole range of key individuals from the idea that the exploitation is more fundamental than oppression, and that you needed to address the whole changing of the nature. We needed a socialist revolution. We needed the class struggle. You know, the class struggle is absolutely key. Into a position where identity became the core elements, in which people retreated into a position where identity politics became the dominant form of politics, and a form of reformism, but also a really serious and, you know, disastrous retreat, really, from the ideas that class struggle is the way to change the world, that class struggle actually changes individuals as well and unites people. And I think we need to address those, you know, those shortcomings, recover those memories and that history, and intervene when we are on Pride, when we are whatever we were doing. We need to talk to people about that alternative history, and that is the way forward for us as, you know, as socialists, you know, to argue with people who are attracted by those sorts of identity politics ideas. I haven't got time to go into queer theory. We can do that later if you want. That's another important issue. Okay, I'll shut up.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Susan Rosenthal. I'm from Canada, and really wanted to agree with everything that you said.
Can you speak into the mic?
Oh, I'm not speaking into the mic. Agree with everything you said. I just wanted to add that prior to Stonewall, the gay and lesbian organizations that existed were all about respectability. It was, how do we present ourselves in such a way that we can be accepted into society? So whenever there was any public lobbying or events, you had to wear a suit, the women had to wear dresses. If you were flamboyant or flaunting or a queen or a street person or basically working class, then we don't want you. You know, we don't want you at all because you're going to give us a bad name. Now, Stonewall changed that completely because the people in the forefront of the fight were exactly those people who had been the most oppressed, had the most to gain by fighting back, and ended up pushing the whole liberation struggle forward, which was incredibly inclusive, as the speaker mentioned. It was about if it was about taking off the restrictions on sexuality for everyone, and it was about fighting the oppression of being in these very tight gender roles that are oppressive for men and women, gay and straight, for everyone. Now, and as the speaker mentioned, as the gay liberation movement rose up after the civil rights movement, the women's liberation movement, it came up at the tail, and it was the first to drop. And the first drop was the split between the men and the women. Right, where the women said, "Well, you're not representing me." You begin to see this in the movie Pride. You see the beginning of that split, and so it came back to the question of respectability. now under the name of identity politics. Who is really gay? Are you gay if you're bi? No, you're not. You know, you don't belong with us. You belong over there. You know, are you really a woman? Are you really whatever? And this, just wanted to add that, this is nothing new, just a new name, that the alliance of conservatives and right-wing feminists is not only, you know, appearing in the attack on trans women in particular, who is a woman, who's a real woman, but also in the attack on sex workers as being not real women, not women, women who are make us all look not respectable. And I think that they are not on the left. To my mind, they're on the right, and that they should be understood as such.
Thank you.
In the wake of the gay marriage rulings, I was having a number of discussions with people I know who have got a very good record in fighting for gay rights, some of whom were coming with two arguments. The first one is, yes, gay marriage is a victory, but it's a cosmetic victory, and ultimately leads to the legitimization of the institution of marriage by redefining it to affect where people's consciousness is. And so it's partly a reactionary thing which helps stabilize marriage as an institution. The other thing that they're arguing was, yes, we're winning on gay rights. We've got Pride the film. People are going to watch it and things. Particularly in places like Ireland and the US, capitalism can afford to grant gay marriage. So where we should be putting our resources is the fight for abortion rights. Because in Ireland and the States, abortion rights is very much under attack. I think these ideas show the fragmentation of the way in which people think as a result of the fallout in the 70s, that either you fight for abortion rights or you fight for gay rights. And it's where a lot of people's heads really are, because I think the Marxist argument about it's down to class, it's down to capitalism, hasn't been won. The Marxist argument hasn't been won partly due to the way in which it's been argued by a number of people that, okay, you suffer from gay oppression, just get involved in a strike and your oppression will go away, or just have a revolution, your oppression will go away, without taking people's real experiences, the way in which they suffer under capitalism. And that was the flip side of the people who are saying, well, once we have gay marriage, then that's all we need, then that's sufficient reforms. Because Marxists isolated themselves from the real discussions, the reformers can come through with very limited reforms which don't challenge capitalism. I think we are in a position now. I think the gay marriage results were a victory, but it's a victory in which we can use to take forward, where we can say the same people who are trying to control who gay people and lesbians are allowed to marry are the ones who are trying to say who women, what women are allowed to do with their own bodies. The people who are profiting from a definition of a definition of family, a definition of who's allowed to love each other, are the ones who are profiting on other things, and that the fight for individual sexuality, the fight against individual oppression, should start with the oppression. But unless it's linked with the fight to capitalism, the different struggles go against again and are used against each other. And the gay rights is used as something to fight against abortion rights rather than everything coming together. There are the high points of the Russian Revolution, the wake of 1968. That's our tradition in terms of saying one victory is good, but let's use that to go forward towards further victories.
Thank you.
Just before I make the main point I wish to, I'd actually like to come back on that, because I think that's very, very simplistic. There are lots of people in the LGBT community who can reproduce, and so abortion rights are very important. Pretty much anyone who's bi, lots of people who are trans, it is an important issue. Especially it's an important issue for myself, because I've had trouble accessing contraception, which I desperately need to lessen my own dysphoria. And because I have said that to doctors, I have been told before, get out of my doctor's office. It is the norm. So these things all come together. There's no point talking about the split, because the split isn't really there, except on people who work around respectability, but that's another issue. One thing I wanted to talk about on gay marriage is, it was a great victory, but I don't know how many people here know about the trans clause in it. That if you get a gay marriage, then your partner has complete control over your transition. They can say no by law, and it must be respected. And in the same, but also recently Ireland got gay marriage, it also got the declaration where if you are trans, you can say, I am trans, I am this gender in Ireland, and it will be recognised. You don't need to go to a panel of doctors you've never met and for them to say, yeah, okay, we'll recognise you now, which is amazing that Ireland's doing better than we are at the moment. And that as a non-binary person, I was actually advised by someone to go to the Northern Ireland Gender Identity Clinic because they're doing better than ours, which scared me a little bit. It's like, really, Belfast? But that's the sort of place that we're in at the moment, that I have found that since I've come out, since I've started transitioning, that it is absolutely horrifying that it seems to be so quiet, because although we see high-profile people transitioning, there's so little talk about violence until somebody's dead, and that seems to be the constant. That I actually have been attacked in the last month, and it's already been shelved by the local police, that this is this is the day in the life, but it seems to be totally forgotten. So I wouldn't talk about like moving any like people from one fight to another. I mean, I can't even get a lot of support at prides and various prides I go to. I have trouble finding a gender-neutral toilet at a pride. But this is one of the things. It's more about, you know, the more we can bring together, the more we can bring up that these things are obviously happening, are obviously a problem, and are not a problem within the state itself. Then we can talk about things wider. Because I didn't trust the police from the beginning, partly as a revolutionary, partly as a scouser. But, you know... But you're told, you know, you're meant to report it, you're meant to have your paper trail, but we know that these things are otherwise. So it's a good thing that I can tell to the younger people I know at the university just coming out, you're going to have these issues, but it is okay. This is not your fault. This is something wider than you. And it's a good way to keep solidarity on the day-to-day.
I first came to Marxism 20 years ago, and I joined the SWP at a meeting very similar to this one. And the reason I joined it was because of something, I talked about something that happened to me a couple of years before when I was a student working part-time in a cinema. And I was outed, and I got a load of homophobic abuse, and then I was sacked. And the people I knew on the scene and the people at uni, well, it's your fault for allowing yourself to be outed. You know, you were, you know, somebody at work, the gay guy at work outed me. To the other people at work. He was a bear, he fitted in, they trusted him, they thought I was straight, I was a quiet guy, not anymore. But yeah, I didn't fit into their stereotype of what a gay person should be, so they're quite freaked out by this. And I was sacked. And then, but I went around and I asked people to support me against the management. It was been open 7 years, the cinema, it was up in the north, no union, no nothing. You know, people, everybody had been sacked, a lot had just gone. And I appealed against the decision. Every single person at workplace, including the homophobe, supported me against the management. So, you know, the argument that you say is a simplistic thing about class struggle, actually it's not simplistic at all. They knew that, you know, if I get bored doing nothing, I did the work, they realised if they could get rid of me for no reason, then they could get rid of anybody for no reason. And actually, I won my job back, and then people started questioning, why are we getting our full taxi fares paid home every night? Why is our pay still £2.75 an hour? This was in the early 90s, it was still shit even in those days, though. But, you know, people started questioning these things. We got a pay rise, we got taxes, you know, you saw a rise of confidence, and I've actually, and those people, they changed, their homophobia died down. I had almost no homophobia in that cinema after that. So actually, you know, it's a concrete example of how fighting back does actually change people and why class struggle is central. You know, you can fight for the gains, you can fight for legal rights. You know, they made huge gains in South Africa. They made, LGBT rights are written into the constitution. But because as the struggle has gone back against the working class, you see that LGBT people are getting attacked in South Africa. You know, because people are losing the sense of fighting for revolution. They thought they had something. They did get rid of the old ruling class, and they just replaced it with one of different colour, basically. So I think, you know, the idea that actually class struggle is central is absolutely key. And when we do fight back, I mean, how, you know, you look at the bus, you know, when the workers on strike in London on the buses last a couple of months back, the picket lines are multicoloured and multiracial, multigendered, and an expression of modern society. And it's very hard for people to hold on to those ideas that the media constantly push down us, including a lot at the top of the Labour Party, unfortunately, about being against migrants and so on and dividing us. It's through the struggle that that's when we really see the chance to change people and change ourselves and not just dismiss people because they're homophobic, but actually say, well, actually there's reasons for it, but if you stand together and fight together, then you can have that argument with them. In my current workplace, the Muslim guys are fine that I work with, the black Christians, the Filipino Catholics. The only time I had some hassle a few years ago was from a straight white bloke in a very unhappy marriage.
Well done, mate. Hi, my name is Madeline Johansson. I'm a member of the Irish SWP. And I just want to say a few words about the really incredible marriage equality referendum that we had on the 22nd of May this year. I think it's a campaign that's been going for a long time with sort of yearly marches that have been taking place for the last few years. And when the referendum was announced, there was a very high level support in the polls and so on for this. But I suppose in the last 2 weeks or so before the referendum, there was a kind of shift in the atmosphere around the country, and particularly in Dublin, where you saw people walking around with yes or ta badges all over the place. There was a real kind of sense that we have a chance to make a change, to stand up to the bigots, stand up to the Catholic Church, and stand up to these people who've been trying to control the working class in particular for so long in Ireland. And it was the first time for a whole new generation of people who had their chance to say something and to stand up to these people. And that's why people came out in such huge numbers to vote in the referendum, one of the highest turnout in a referendum ever in Ireland. And young people travelling from all over the place, young people who have been forced to emigrate because of the economic circumstances and such high levels of unemployment, were travelling home from England, from Scotland, from Wales, from everywhere all across Europe, travelling home to Ireland specifically to vote in the referendum. And when the results came out, there was this amazing celebration, and it was just absolutely incredible. But as Laura also pointed out, we also made some criticisms in terms of just fighting for marriage equality is not enough. But I think there's some people on the left who kind of go only for the criticism and don't understand what a great opportunity it was and how it gave people confidence to stand up to the priests, to stand up to the establishment and say, look, we're actually not as backward as the politicians seem to think that we are, or the church seem to think that we are. And this has given people confidence, and now people are really talking about the issue of abortion rights, of getting that changed, and there's several campaigns ongoing on that, and it's giving the people the confidence to stand up and say, look, we're not going to listen to you guys anymore, and we're much more progressive than you think we are.
I always find this a very interesting and very, very stimulating subject to think about. The thing I'm writing about the period now between 1918 and 1945, and if you really look at the end result of that, the final result, McCarthyism, a huge backlash against sexuality. We see sterilizations of homosexuals in the Netherlands on a scale that we had never seen before. It's a backlash, which is I would call it counter-revolution. But how is it possible? Because we know that the bourgeoisie does not accept ourselves shaping our lives. The point is, why do they get away with it? Why don't we have a counterforce? What bloody happened after the Russian Revolution? Well, you may all know, but I'm going to tell you anyway, because I was surprised to find out. We know, of course, that Russia was crucial in the 1930s. You had a Stalinist counter-revolution. Stalin reconstituted Russian society, including the family, crucially. Leon Trotsky, in his works on the women's question in Russia of that time, is very observant of how crucial this is to reconstituting, in fact, Russian capitalism. And from that, of course, flows forth a hold on gays. It's completely consistent. This actually comes forward in 1933, 1934, when you have the Reichstag fire. Are you aware of that? In the Reichstag fire, a number of communists were implicated in, lighting it probably, and there were a number of people on trial at that moment. And Dimitrov, who had this rotten fashion theory, he had a brilliant speech and defended himself, and he was greatly admired, and what have you. But there was one guy, and incidentally he was Dutch, Marinus van der Lubbe, and he was put to death. Why? Because the whole bloody Comintern let him down. They called him unreliable because he was homosexual, he had been Röhm's lust boy, and so on and so forth. Actually, what you have to imagine is that at that point, homosexuality was a practice by the rich, on the courts, everywhere. Krupp actually committed suicide because his homosexuality came forth through the Italian paparazzi, where he had no power and he'd been playing with Italian boys in the hotels and so. The whole... The German Kaiser had pink ballets by generals strange things happen, like men walking around in ballet suits. We can't hardly imagine that happening at our courts today, but it was very, and in that context they took like a shortcut, like homosexuality is corrupt, you can see it, the rich do it, and so they started to denounce homosexuality and so forth. Actually, in this situation, the defense of homosexuality and all...
Can you sum up now,
being,
please?
Yes, I'm trying to do that. And all other sorts of being ended up in the Trotskyist corner, and it's not surprising. So I'm very happy that we're still continuing this proud...
Thank you, comrade.
Today.
A couple of basic points, really. Just last month, I was at the EIS Trade Union Conference in Perth, and in Scotland. And because it's a trade union conference, you get lots of morning stars knocking around, and it kind of grieves you that another socialist organisation could be so damaged in middle-paid spread. A trans journalist spent the two pages attacking the Malone for being rich, glamorous, and having so recently become trans and having lived so long as a man that they had no clue what real trans life could be like. And so big thank you to Laura for her article in Socialist Review for it's pride for all of us all the time when our politics are head and shoulders, I think, above others. But one of the big wake-up calls in that conference was that I put a motion on how LGBT, bullying, whether it's in the workplace, whether it's in the staff room, whether it's in the classroom, has to be challenged by all of us. And as a boringly straight person, I put that motion forward. And of course, it was passed unanimously. But what was quite gobsmacking for me was for the rest of the week, people kept coming up to me going, "You're so brave. It's so wonderful. Thank you so much." You think, my God, what took me as an SWP member of 40 years, to actually get to a conference and put a motion like that? So if anybody hasn't put a motion to their union conference, get on with it.
Thank you. Unfortunately, due to time, Josh is going to be the last speaker. I'm really sorry for anyone else who put their hands up, but really, I've got to bring it to a close.
So I just want to start by thanking Laura so much for her talk and also for the things that she's been writing. It's fantastic when I speak to people in demonstrations and stuff and they know who she is and they know the things that she's writing about. That's really wonderful. It's a credit to the SWP and it's a credit to Laura and the work that she does. I just want to talk about how struggle helps to bring about progress for all things, including LGBT rights, and moving in baby steps towards liberation. I mean, we need a revolution basically to achieve liberation, but there's so much to do along the way and some pretty basic things. And the example that I would give you is why I'm holding this today. And unfortunately, Liam and Jordan, who are at the forefront of this campaign, are not here yet. They're coming later in the weekend due to commitments. But essentially, Jordan and Liam met during the independence referendum in Scotland. Jordan's experiences growing up as a gay youth in Scottish schools. Liam is a Grangemouth Unite tanker driver who has a partner and a four-year-old daughter. The two of them met up through the politics of the independence struggle, and they became extraordinarily close friends. In fact, they kind of described themselves as soulmates. And Jordan taught Liam about tacit homophobia, transphobia, and so forth that exists in society, particularly in Scotland. I could imagine it's probably very similar in England and Wales. But Liam came to realize that this is an important issue that needs to be addressed. Essentially, his angle is that he doesn't want his four-year-old daughter to grow up to be a teenager who's part of the problem. He wants her to be part of the solution. And so Liam and Jordan have come together and written articles about their different perspectives on the issue, and decided to engage on education and to try and put a bill through the Scottish Parliament to make LGBTI plus education mandatory in all Scottish schools so that no schools can opt out of it. In Scotland, you may know that sectarianism is still quite alive and dangerous, and a lot of backwards schools for religious reasons will swerve LGBT education, and it becomes a place where homophobia and transphobia festers, and it spreads out into the wider society, and it results in attacks on people and all kinds of terrible things. So we are putting demands on the government during the independence referendum, envisioning the kind of society that we want to live in that has inspired people to pick up a campaign, and we want to drive that through the education system so that we can create the better world that we want to live in. And we have to do that in small ways sometimes that are reformist but are extraordinarily important and transform people's ideas and their perspective on what we can, what kind of society we can live in.
Thank you, Josh. Laura, over to you.
Thanks, comrades. Really interesting discussion, a whole series of really important points made. I think I won't take long, but just a couple of points, really. Comrade mentioned the violence which trans people face. I didn't dwell on that, but there are sources you can look at. But it is it is enormous. I mean, the violence against trans people seems to be even worse than the violence that's meted out to gay people. Over and over again, you see, murders and attacks and so on around the world. I mean, I was looking on there's a website called Remembering Our Dead, which didn't look as though it was actually working when I got on it a few days ago. But, they talk about the tip of the iceberg, the number of trans people who are murdered each year, and they were talking about hundreds, right across the world in the most appallingly brutal ways, and ways in which are not recognised sometimes by the courts. So people get away with the murders on the grounds of provocation and stuff like this. I mean, absolutely appalling stuff. There was a terrible case in America not that long ago of this. Anyway, it's bad. Russia is an interesting example because people will know, I mean, the situation for LGBT people currently in Russia is awful. Not only are people discriminated against, including being hunted down by fascist and ultra-nationalist militias and beaten up and attacked physically as well as humiliated in other sorts of ways. But where has that come from? I mean, it's a tragedy, isn't it? If you think about it in the long historical terms, that here was Russia post-revolution, in terms of what the Bolsheviks achieved for LGBT people, for gay people in particular at that time, and you have a situation now where people are attacked, people can't protest, they're hunted down. And the answer, one of the answers for why that's happening is, of course, it's not unconnected to the fact that the meltdown of the USSR in 1989, the huge crisis, economic and political crisis, that Russia went through, where people at the bottom of society and the middle of society in Russia were hugely damaged, massive poverty and so on and so forth. And in those situations, the state, because this is pretty much state-sponsored, this homophobia, rise in homophobia, looks to scapegoating a vulnerable minority, and that's happened. I didn't really get a chance to talk about much about the situation in the 30s, but you had the ironic situation as the Russian Revolution degenerated, the idea of socialism in one country, the rise of Stalin and so on and so forth. You went from a situation in which women's rights took a huge step forward, immediately after the revolution, to a situation in which women are given medals for having more children, and in which the state increasingly used homophobia and homophobic arguments to attack Nazi Germany, because a number of leading Nazis were known to be gay. And conversely, the Nazis were attacking Russian communism because it was seen to be sexually libidinous and free, free sexual relations and decadent and so on and so forth. So they were using similar sorts of mirror image arguments to attack each other, prior to the war. Right. I guess, again, I didn't mention key people that I had on my wonderful slides that you never saw. But, there's a wonderful quote I came across about the family, which I want to read very briefly. It's from Eleanor Burke Leacock's book, The Myths of Male Domination. It's quite an old book, 1981, but there's a really nice quote. She says, "The notion of a somehow separate woman's role hides the reality of the family as an economic unit, an institution as crucial for the continued exploitation of working men as it is for the oppression of women. To understand this family form and its origins is fundamental to the interpretation of social structure, past and present, and to the understanding of how to fight for and win the right of the world's people to make decisions about their future." And we know that it is possible to make those decisions. Greek working class has just done something, a big step along the way in terms of doing that. She's drawing really on Engels' ideas, isn't she? I didn't mention Engels, but she's drawing on Engels' idea. If you look at Engels' book, I mean, I know, again, I'm sure these are debates that go on. How relevant is Engels these days? I think Engels, you know, should be defended for what he argued about the family and how he talked about the role of women and the role of the nuclear family and so on. He comes under criticism, I know, but I think we have in the past defended Engels' views and Engels' approach, and I think we should continue to do the same thing. And I think finally, really, I guess the problem, I alluded to it, but there is a problem. If you start from the wrong position, you inevitably, I'm talking about a theoretical political position. If you start from the wrong position, you are going to end up with the wrong conclusions and the wrong practice. And what I mean by that is that if you start from a position of accepting identity politics, for example, if you start from a position, I know queer theory was a reaction against identity politics and the accommodation with the system. Effectively, it was partly a call to reject the pink pound and you know the accommodation that goes, the political accommodation that goes with identity theory. It was a reaction, but it was still within the bounds of a reformist tradition that rejected Marxism, rejected the idea that fundamental to the way we live our lives in capitalism is the way in which the societies are structured to produce profit, to produce goods, and not to produce materials for our needs, not to satisfy our needs, but to derive profit. That is fundamental. However else we're divided up, that is fundamental, and it's the clue to how we need to unite and fight back on the picket lines. My college is actually on strike. Bradford College is on strike today. So, big shout out to Bradford College. I should have been on the picket lines, but I'm here. I feel so guilty. But when we're on those picket lines, it doesn't matter if you're male, female, something else, black, white, whatever. You're on the picket lines. You know who your enemy is. The experience of standing together shoulder to shoulder, fighting, doing all that organising, exercising democracy actually in decision making is fundamental, and fundamentally changes people's ideas. And that's the clue. We need more of that. We need to build that sort of movement that pulls us all together. I know there are issues, and we addressed during the weekend as well. I haven't addressed the question of intersectionality, for instance. Which is an issue. I haven't addressed the question of the arguments around reproductive rights, and there is a whole debate going on about who is a woman and who should be involved in that, and who shouldn't, as some people are arguing. Those debates, I guess, will go on all this weekend, and we need to have those debates and those discussions with people who want to fight back. The key thing here is, when people want to fight back, whatever their political position, in a sense, we unite with them in order to have a better chance of winning, but in order also to engage politically and to question ideologically where they're coming from and where and what we've got to offer and what we can learn from the struggle with them collectively. So I'll finish on that, otherwise I'll just go rambling on.
Thank you, Laura.